go, salam, 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 or at least a parting of the sea, as it were, parting of it. And they come in sometimes with their whichever category security they have, and no one blinks, and no one leaves their conversations to go rushing up to Minister Ji to say welcome, welcome, or whatever they say. It devastates them, and they immediately complain of an instant stomachache and leave the party. Because they're just not accustomed to people treating them like just regular folks who are there to talk and converse and meet other guests. They expect everybody, everything to come to a standstill. When that doesn't happen, it's such a huge ego blow that it's just better to leave the party than hang around and be like everybody else. It's very interesting to see the same people in power and out of power. I'm sure that must happen when they come to parties in Delhi as well. But in Delhi, people do have a memory about former netas and probably give them respect?
No, I think it's respect. Just self-preservation. They know that they can come back to power, so they better be careful. What about you, Moni? What's Lahore like with politicians? At least you have beautiful wives like Reham Khan. We don't
Reham
have
Khan.
That. Huh? Well, I think she's beautiful.
She who eats sausage.
Yes.
I don't know, but before I answer your question, Shobha, I will say that you said that nobody remembers partition and the young people. Oh. I beg to differ. I went this morning to the hairdresser to the first floor, and there this lady was washed and blow dried my hair, and then towards the end she said, "Ma'am, aap partition is side pe karenge ki is side?" So the partition is well and alive. So I said, "Meri aap left side pe partition karte." Sorry, your question.
No, the question was about politicians in Pakistan. Do they behave as badly as politicians in India?
I think worse.
Really?
I think
what
worse.
What is their MO?
We always live with the with the fear that the fear and lovely
fear.
Army, you know, we live with this fear that any moment we might just be bundled out. So the thing is that you've got to make as much as you make as quickly as you can. And I think that is a sort of thing that sets our politicians apart. There's a kind of ungainly, unseemly hurry to help themselves as much as quickly as possible. I think your guys are a little...
Sounds very familiar.
Maybe yours are a little, you know, because they know they're there for 5 years.
Come to Maharashtra and find out.
but you have your generals too. We don't have that. I mean, we have generals, but they are not in politics.
They come to India to take conclave, yeah. No, ours are very much there. As I said, we live in fear of being bundled out by them all the time. When I say we, I mean the civilian government. So, yeah, and the generals also, I mean, the generals more than anybody else are helping themselves with their noses and the snouts in the trough, you know.
Just a last question, and then I'll ask the audience to ask questions as well. Shobha, has distance helped you also? The fact that you don't live in Delhi allows you to be out of the Luttian's zone and the Luttian's mindset, and you can write more dispassionately about power and politics.
No, the fact I that think you distance is always a good thing when you're a journalist. Like when I was editing Stardust, I never ever really met with Bollywood stars. I never attended parties. I didn't go to any of the premieres or any film-related event. I think a healthy distance definitely keeps your mind clear and as objective as it's possible. We all have our prejudices, we all have our preferences, but keeping a distance is something I would recommend greatly to anybody who's in the public space trying to speak in a voice that is independent. And I think a lot of our anchors, if they weren't that cozy with politicians and on sort of first name terms on panel discussions, would lead to panel discussions which have more probably relevance, meaning maybe they'll be able to get perspectives which aren't so cozy after all. I think distance is very good and very healthy and very recommended.
Rajdeep, you want to take that question? Okay. Sorry?
I don't use
words. Okay, questions from the audience? No? Okay, we'll just continue this conversation. Oh, there is. Yeah, please.
And I just wanted to add Kavri, because that didn't come up, but at the Lahore Lit Fest,
yeah,
it was, which was very recent, just about 3 or 4 weeks ago, under really very daunting circumstances, there had been a suicide bomb attack a few kilometers from the venue of the Lit Fest.
Yes.
And the government had told the organizers that they could not provide security. When those of us who did turn up, and I can see John and others in the audience who were there, those who came from overseas, you came from London and so on, to come to a Lit Fest with snipers on the rooftop, with people in combat gears, with people flashing Kalashnikovs with their fingers on the trigger, there were probably as many police people there and as many really heavily armed people there as there were participants. And despite that, the city arrived in the hundreds to participate in something where you're risking your life. And the opinion
and
that...
And your clothes, because it was raining.
It was, and your clothes, of course.
And shoes.
And shoes. But it was incredible. I mean, the people came, there was hardly any place to sit. There were people 10 deep sitting in the aisles. So I would say, and the opinions that were being shared were so brave and so strong and so fearless, including from your own intellectuals and lawyers who were talking about the government without the slightest concern about
the army.
And sorry?
And the army.
And the army, exactly. That is something that I think we should all acknowledge, because we are seeing less and less and less of that here, and this entire kind of almost a paranoia that should we say this, should
yeah,
we not,
right,
should we tackle this in public or not? Are there going to be mobs at my door, as there have been with me over tweets, to have police protection? It's a very uncomfortable, awful feeling. It's never happened in our country before, and all of us should strenuously fight it and raise
but
our voices,
know, Shobha,
when we see it.
I would like to reiterate what you said and also some things which were said yesterday. I think, you know, what Lahore Literary Festival and gatherings like this do is to allow us to mingle and express our views freely. And I think that's absolutely... It's vitally important for people, certainly in Pakistan, I can't say about India, but certainly in Pakistan, for them to see Indians, to meet with Indians, to see that they don't have horns on their heads and tails and cloven hooves, so that they can, you know, they can be a fair and sort of free exchange of views. And people can then look beyond the propaganda that we are fed day and night about how we are sworn enemies and will remain sworn enemies. If you remember, I mean, I don't know if you saw this, but at the festival, the events which were the most crowded were those with Indians on them, because the Pakistani public wants to hear what Indians have to say. They don't want mediation. They want to hear it from
directly,
them.
Yes.
Directly.
Yeah.
And I think if there could be, you know, as I was saying, this bloody visa problem is so acute. If we could possibly have greater interaction, I think it would make for much healthier relations.
You know, when I did come in 1993 and I was wearing saris almost throughout, and I did experience a sense of deep-rooted suspicion, yeah, and wariness. And I was I walked out of into the marketplace, and a little boy hid behind his mother and tugged at her dupatta and said, "Ammi, ammi, dekhiye, dushman."
Oh, wow.
You know, so it came as such a shock to me that a
right.
child would identify a woman in a sari with a bindi,
yeah,
and in his mind, that person was the dushman. That was the indoctrination for a long time that happened in schools, in colleges. That has definitely changed. It continues?
In Pakistan, yeah. I mean, in the textbooks, etc., it is there. But, you know,
our textbooks are being rewritten,
yes.
So we have a new version of our own history.
We'll know soon what they sound like or read like. No, but has social media and, you know, festivals like this changed the perception or no?
A little bit, but you know, the thing is that how many Pakistanis come to something like this?
Yeah.
I think there's me and Hussein here.
Hmm.
And, you know, there'll be a handful of Indians at the literary festival. We have to liberalize this visa policy so people can come and go with greater ease.
What about social media? Hasn't that helped? There's no mediation there.
Social media, you know, I think you have to meet people face to face. I really do. Social media does work to some extent, but you have to engage more freely. And also remember, as somebody who uses email certainly a lot as well as Twitter, tone doesn't carry. You know, you'll be making a joke and it doesn't come across. But when you meet people, it does. Sorry, there were questions.
Yes, please. This gentleman? Yeah. But we're not going to let you get away with no air kissing lessons, huh? That we have to do. I know. We have to.
I've removed my partition.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
I am Firoz Bakht Ahmed. I have a question for both of you. Both of you spoke very well, especially in your letters. The question is very simple. When, you know, people from Pakistan like Moni is here, Imran Khan, or yesterday we heard Hussein Haqqani, you speak very well, you speak about friendship. Now, and as you said that the governments are sworn enemies, now who are the people who benefit because of enmity between India and Pakistan? Why can't people like you or from our side also, can't we bring a revolution and we can once again become friends as we were before partition?
I think in Pakistan, I certainly know that the trading community is very, very keen for there to be greater interaction between our two countries. I know that a lot of NGOs have already made contact with their counterparts in India. My books sell the most in India. This is my biggest market. The number of festivals that I've been to in India far outweighs the number of festivals I've been to anywhere else in the world. So ordinary people, I think, do want it. I think the vested interest in Pakistan is basically just the military. You know, their whole existence is based on the insistence that there is an enemy out there, which makes them the guardians of our nation, and so they can therefore be in positions of power. I think it only serves their interest, and also their proteges, who are the jihadis.
Cohen, you had a question?
Moni, this is for you. You said that you are an eavesdropper and a voyeur. I'd love to have a snippet of, in the last 2 days, what you have observed here for us, please.
Please. Aap dekhenge. You'll have to wait. I mean, I gave you the partition thing because it was in my mind. But you'll just have to wait because it has to marinate for a little bit, and then it'll come out as fine wine.
Any more questions? There was, yes, Sachin. Yes, Mala. You're better at this.
I have to say, Moni, I read every word you write, every single week, and your books, please write more books because I've run out of.
Thank you.
I just want to know, what is the hope for the Kulchus of the world in your country now? Because he doesn't have the emotional connect that perhaps our generation had with India. And there is a memory, even through the eyes of our parents, of the partition. But Kulchu doesn't know that. So is there a connect between his generation and...
You know, I think that's both good and bad. My father went to school in Pakistan, in Lahore, and a lot of his classmates were are now Indians. They were, you know, they were Indians then too, but they crossed at partition. And every year at the anniversary of the school or for weddings or whatever, they all come over. And the numbers are dwindling because
they are passing away. But we have made friends with their children, and they are coming to stay with me in London next month. It's good in the sense that we have a connection, and we can continue with the connection. And it's bad in the sense that some people still have very painful memories of partition. So people like Kulchu, I think, can take the good and leave out the bad, because they're in a place where they really don't have any memories or any baggage, and they are free to do as they wish. And particularly I've seen, you know, when we live out of India and Pakistan, when our children are at universities, when we are, I mean, I have a friend here who was with me at university, and I'm very touched that he came today. And I think we meet without any sort of prejudices and hang-ups when we meet outside. So that gives me great hope that we will be able to surmount these present difficulties.
The absolutely last question, Seth.
Hi, Kaveri. My question is for Shobha. Hello. You are celebrated as a person who says anything she wants, to whom she wants, when she wants, how she wants, and for whatever reason she finds fit. Now my question is, many times people shoot the rifle off their friends' shoulders. Would you allow that, or is everything you bring out there your absolute personal own opinion?
I put myself on the line. I don't need someone else's shoulder to shoot from time to time.
No, someone else using your shoulder.
It hasn't happened so far. I doubt that it will. I don't see that happening, honestly, ever. I can say that completely with complete conviction. It has never happened.